CPA Trendlines presents a production of Accounting Influencers with Rob Brown.
It's old, it's broken, and we have to fix it. And I think one of the things that's really holding us back, quite frankly, is the compensation model.
There's never been a better time to be an accountant, and that is because it's a profession that changes. There's always something new.
Those young folks that we're trying to pull in, they can go to any tech company out there or any of the newer companies that have launched, and it's more exciting. It's more of what they want to do.
It's the Accounting Influencers podcast with me, Rob Brown, your host. We are doing a series of panels on the future of accounting. And to do this, it's not just my opinion that counts. It's these, the good and the great leaders, experts, influencers who are influencing policy, talking to accountants all the time. Some of them are accountants. They know where we are right now. And more importantly, they know where we are going because they have served this profession for a long time and they know what works and what doesn't. I'm going to get the guests to introduce themselves in just a moment. This is one of several that we are doing with nearly 100 influencers because there's a lot of diverse opinions. Everyone's got a clue. Everyone's got a viewpoint. We're trying to bring some consensus together and give you the view in the round. So without further ado, my old friend, Sam Louis, please say hello and introduce yourself, Sam.
Thanks, Rob. And a little less than the old, if you don't mind. Just teasing. Seriously, though, I'm Sam Louis. I'm the chief executive of Praxity Global Alliance. We're an alliance of independent accounting, auditing, and tax firms around the world, with recently our most best results ever of just short of 10 billion turnover. So growing and exciting place to be right now.
Wonderful. And a great international perspective you bring. Jeff Phillips, you and I have become acquainted a lot recently. We're running the Accounting Talent podcast, so I know that's very much on your heart. A quick introduction from you, sir.
Hi, everybody. I'm Jeff Phillips. I'm the CEO of Paget. We're a 58-year-old tax and accounting franchise that serves accounting and tax needs for small businesses. We have over 300 independently owned offices in the U.S. and Canada. Prior to that, I founded Accounting Fly in 2011. Accounting Fly is a boutique staffing firm. We match CPAs with corporate accounting teams and CPA firms with remote U.S.-based CPAs. And I've been involved with probably over 1,000 hires into CPA firms over the past decade.
Great to have you with us, Jeff. Maureen, Prime Global, lovely to have you with us. A quick intro, please.
Thanks so much, Rob. I'm Maureen Dillmore. I am the executive director for the Americas region of Prime Global, which is the third largest association. So much like Sam, we have a lot of really strong independent firms as our members. And while I'm not an accountant myself, I've been working with them for over 15 years and have heard a lot of what they have to say.
Great. And bringing a huge amount of gravitas to the conversation. Sandra Wiley, delighted to have you with us.
Well, I am grateful to be here and also excited to be with all of these wonderful people on the panel, including you, Rob. So thank you for inviting me. I'm the president at Boomer Consulting. We are a group of amazing professionals who work exclusively with public accounting firms to guide them to growth, sustainable success, and innovation. And we do that through our communities, through training, and through consulting. So I am thrilled to be here and love the part of the conversation where we get to debate a little bit. Love that.
Yeah. Let's do that indeed. Some things we will agree on, some things we won't. We were going to open up by asking about where the threats are coming from accounting. And Maureen, I'll start with you on this. If we take for granted that pretty much all firms are growing right now, and throughout the pandemic they have done, they're growing whether they like it or not. They've got more business than they can handle. That might bring in a bit of complacency, which may be one of the threats, but we're certainly not taking things for granted. We know the world is changing. From where you sit, Maureen, where are the threats coming from? What should accountants be wary of right now?
Well, there's a lot of change happening, and I wouldn't want to put a lot of that as a threat to the industry. However, when we're looking at things right now, a big threat, of course, is staffing and getting people interested in becoming accountants, and still kind of the overriding stereotype that accountants are boring and that the career is boring. And that seems to be, you can look at a lot of different things about tech and cyber tech and regulatory changes. But if we're just trying to get people in to do the work, I would still say we're looking at staffing and getting that pipeline of qualified accountants coming up.
Sandra, what's rocking the boat from where you sit?
You know, I agree with Maureen, although I would add that it's that old business model that has been around since the beginning of time, that hierarchy with people at the top that tell everybody else what to do. And it's old. It's old, it's broken, and we have to fix it. And I think one of the things that's really holding us back, quite frankly, is the compensation model. Because right now, leaders are making a lot of money and they are not wanting to spread the wealth. And we have this young talent, like Maureen said, we have this young talent that we're trying to bring them in and get them excited about being in accounting. And guess what? They can go to any tech company out there or any of the newer companies that have launched, and it's more exciting and it's more of what they want to do. So we have got to start putting some emphasis on changing the business model, really upgrading our talent and the way that we treat and value our talent. I think that's going to have to happen before anything can really change.
Yeah. Jeff, I know you're licking your lips at this question, but I'm holding you back. Sam, where do you feel the challenges and the threats are coming from for accounting?
Well, less of a threat, but more of a challenge, I think, is going to be how the accounting profession deals with ESG over the coming years, how it looks at how it's advising its clients around it, how different countries think about ESG is going to inform what firms in different countries do. I think the European model is going to lead the way. Other countries are going to, some of them follow very happily. Some of them are going to follow kicking and screaming. But I think the firms are also going to think about how do they balance their advisory models around ESG as well as their audit and assurance models around ESG. And I think it's a really exciting place to be right now, but it has a lot of challenges and we need to think through a lot of the implications around independence and assurance, real assurance, carefully.
Jeff, what's rocking the status quo from your perspective?
Well, you were supposed to let me go before Sandra because she stole my answer, but I'll agree with her completely and pivot a little bit, speak to the small firms that are watching this podcast and the leaders. There's 30,000 of them over here in the United States, and it's a business model threat. It's about getting paid what you're worth and the incredible value that firms bring to their clients and charging enough to address the next threat, which is being able to afford great talent and keep the great talent, to keep them inside the firm, right? And let them deliver great service. And of course, bring home enough money for the owners themselves. A lot of owners in the small market are struggling because the front end isn't working. They're not charging enough. And they need to do this in a way that gives them not only profit margin, but also time margin, the freedom to work slower, work deeper, and allow their staff time to be flexible, take time off. Let's get to the point where firms aren't working Sundays during our busy season, Rob. I think that you can solve any talent challenge by dealing with the threat that starts with proper business model.
We could identify perhaps a number of threats to the talent pipeline, the brand of the profession, how attractive we make public accounting as a career choice, the money and the compensation, all of these things could play in. But we will talk about talent a little bit more specifically later. Let's talk about who accountants listen to. I read somewhere recently that they are the second most sold to profession in the world. Doctors are the first because every pharmaceutical company wants a conversation with a doctor. And we know why that is. But accountants, as the guardians of business, they are seen as the conduit to all kinds of businesses. So everyone wants to sell accountants things. And we're all speaking to them. We're all shouting at them, buy this, do this, say this. Sam, let's start with you on this. Who do accountants listen to and who should they be listening to?
Well, I think there's a lot of stakeholders that cross the profession, and it depends on the topic. For me, I listen to authoritative sources, and those are usually the people who've been around a while and through a couple of business cycles.
Okay, so influencers, experts like that?
Absolutely. I'm reading a great book at the moment called The Happy Index by James Timpson, and thinking a lot about the business model, about upside down management and what that might mean. And I think in addition to the kinds of conversations firms are having around their business model and ownership models, there's also conversations that we're listening to around strategy. So how do you take a firm and shape it in a way that will satisfy regulators, that will deliver to the client in a positive way while maintaining independence. And I'm listening to anybody who's talking about that.
Maureen, at Prime Global, you're famous for the content and the insights that you put out, your thought leadership. So you would hope accountants are listening to you, but there's so many people that want their ear.
Yeah, of course, there always are. And especially right now, I feel like with so many innovations in the technology space, you know, the accountants have been complaining for a long time about getting work done in cybersecurity and things like that. And there's so many solutions coming to the front. So, you know, people are listening to those AI providers, so long as they're trustworthy and able to save some hours and solve problems for them. But kind of going to the question of who they should be listening to, I think kind of going back to my first answer is they need to be listening to the emerging and future leaders of the profession to kind of tackle that old business model. What they want to see, what they want to see the profession become is who they need to kind of be listening to as well.
Mm. Jeff, who do you feel accountants pay attention to these days?
I think everybody that works in front of a laptop or a computer on the planet should be listening to the author Cal Newport. He's not an accountant, but he wrote two very interesting books. Oh, he's written like 8 New York Times bestsellers, but two I want to recommend is one called A World Without Email. Doesn't that sound nice? And another book called Deep Work. And the reason why you want to listen to Cal, and he has a podcast called Deep Questions. He is a computer science PhD at Georgetown and yet has written multiple New York Times bestsellers about productivity for knowledge workers. And especially how to avoid overwhelm and all of the reactive work that we are besieged with on a daily basis and go on offense and work deeply on the projects that make the most impact. And that's hard to do when you're getting emails all day long. And he has just amazing thoughts on how to make the move from living out of your inbox and being and working on the top priorities in your business. Highly encourage you to check him out because I think he's made a difference in so many people's lives. And I agree with Maureen, where can we find the emerging leaders? And in one source, and it's a shameless plug, but it's Going Concern. This is a snarky blog that sort of pokes fun at life for millennials in the big four and big accounting firms. And you want to understand what the young talent pipeline is listening to and reading and thinking about, go there. And it's fun. It's sometimes irreverent, but it's a good place to kind of check in with that emerging leader set.
Yeah. So we're building up a picture here of the different stakeholders. We talked about tech. We talked about the experts and the influencers and the Cal Newports of the world. We could throw in the governing bodies and the associations and networks that are well represented here. Sandra, mm-hmm. with your boomer circles, you might say their peers are the people they should be listening to. What's your take on this? Who's got their ear?
You know, I thank you for the plug on the circles, because that I do think peer interaction is huge. I think you find some firm out there that's doing really great things and people will follow that, but they have to find the really innovative firms, and they're finding those within the circles because those people are like the best of the best in technology, in growth, in talent, all different areas. And they're just sharing the best ideas with each other. I would also say to the points that have been made about younger generation, I think it's a cross-functional. I just did all the research on a cross-functional team of people from the 5 different generations that we have in this profession today. And you can learn something from every one of those generations, right? So we have to listen to our brand new people coming into the profession. We have to listen to those that are leaving the profession, the baby boomers of the world that are getting ready to retire. We have to start listening to each other and respecting each other and really gaining knowledge from each other. So I think all of that, and we're seeing that in the circles. You see all different kinds of people. And the other people that you see at circles, which you mentioned, were all of our sponsors or what some people call vendors, right? The technology people out there, the people that are bringing the technology to the forefront and saying, use this because it's going to work. And there is thousands of new technologies out there that happen every day. So we have to do all of that. But I will go back to one of the ones I had thought about before we started this call was the consultants, the associations, the leaderships within those areas, the people like Padgett, right? I mean, those people are the ones that we have to listen to. And the really good firms out there, the ones that are really making the transformation into this new business model, They're the ones that are sitting there listening, taking notes, and then going back and implementing. So I think all of that has to do with that change agent piece.
Let's stay with talent for a moment. Look at the brand of the profession. We know about the talent shortages. It's not exclusive to accounting, but it is particularly acute in accounting. We might talk about the fight for relevance and how attractive accounting is as a career choice. We know people are coming out of accounting and into tech and into industry and into entrepreneurship and other places. So my question is, and Sandra, let me start with you on this one. How should the accounting profession brand itself to attract or reattract or become more relevant to the new generations coming through who have so many choices?
I think we have to start talking about what the profession will be like, not necessarily what it is today. Look at the future and see where we're going. Think about and talk about the relationships that we have as a part of the profile today, that we're going to be advising clients, that we're going to be growing a business, and that we're going to have flexibility to work the way you want to work. And we are able to be change agents in our firm, and therefore those young folks that we're trying to pull in, let them see that they're going to be a part of the change, not somebody who has the change thrust upon them. I think that's what they want. You go out and talk to any young person who wants to be a part of this profession. And whoever said it a minute ago about it's just boring and kind of gross, right? That is what they feel. That's what they see. I just talked to a young lady the other day and I said, you should look at accounting. You would be an amazing accountant. And she literally rolled her eyes and said, no, I want an exciting career. And I said, well, let me tell you about firms that have exciting careers. Yeah. And I told her about how some of the firms are onboarding people and getting them involved in relationships right away, training them and teaching them how to be advisors, getting them in front of the clients almost immediately. And she went, okay, I didn't even know that they did that. And I said, that is what we're missing in this profession right now. We're missing the message, the marketing of what we really do. And I think that's a problem. So I think if I was doing it and thinking about it, that's what I would say.
Sam, if we put you in charge of the PR department for the accounting profession worldwide, how would you go about branding it so that we could fill this talent pipeline?
So I think it's about role models. And it's about the right kind of role models who may be real people out there that people who are thinking about a future career can aspire to be. And it's a lifestyle choice, and it's a way of living, and it's a way of thinking, and a culture that they can aspire to. And I think accounting really, really does talk to that. But what I'd really be doing is putting my money in creating a really fun, exciting TV show to do for the accounting profession what Grey's Anatomy did for medicine, or I don't know, Suits did for the legal profession. That just shows that, in fact, it's a great place to meet people. It's a great place to solve problems, to make a difference in the world, where you can just engage with the best and the brightest minds in solving problems.
Jeff, part of this is the stories that we're telling or not telling. A friend of mine is at Deloitte. He went into a school recently to talk about his job. And he asked the children, they were 9 years old, what does an accountant do? And none of them could answer. One kid said, is it something to do with maths? But they had no clue. And even at teenage years, they have this sense of being locked in a dark room, chained to a desk, nailing spreadsheets and complicated maths and things like that. So there's so much going on that we don't talk about. How would you brand accounting to make it attractive?
I love these answers. And, you know, I'm the son of a small firm owner. And I started working in his firm when I was 13. And he was chained to a desk. He was doing tax returns. He was great with clients, and I loved listening to him talk. But he was in that desk working most of the time, and it actually convinced me to not follow his career path. And I made a mistake because the people I've met at places like the Boomer Circles, who are leading dynamic firms as incredible business consultants and advisors, really in the mix of critical conversations with amazing clients. It, Sam said about being a role model. That is the vision of the CPA profession that we ought to portray, because it's noble, it is exciting, it is critical. My take, though, is for those who are in leadership or owners is not to wait on the trade associations to do this work for us, because it's really up to the leaders of the individual firms. They're on the front line. They're going to have to do the work of repositioning their firm, which in aggregate will reposition the profession to keep the talent. And I think this has been brought up before, but one of the key critical pieces we've got to address is compensation. That's a no-brainer, because when you look at the comparison between what early career accountants are making compared to other professions, it's not holding up. Sandra mentioned that earlier. We've got to invest in way more flexible workplaces and trust the staff and invest in the career journey towards that strategic advisor that I see so many partners playing that role of. I love the idea of role modeling, and because there are some amazing role models out there. This disconnect is happening at the firm level more than it is happening at this industry level. Don't wait for someone to save you. Reinvent the business now and fail over and over and over again working on that, but don't wait. There's just too many good people out there and too many potential clients and money out there for everybody to earn, you know, that this shouldn't be a mess.
Maureen, you work with a lot of progressive firms and excited accountants, but there are those types that just do want to be in a dark room. They love the technical side of it. They love complex problems, not particularly always client facing. What's your solution to the brand of the profession?
Yeah, well, I think that it does need a rebrand, because I think, you know, going last, of course, I'm going to kind of pick from what everybody else said, but I'm not from an accounting background. So whenever I tell people I work with accountants, they're, oh, that must be fun. And it's like, oh, but it actually is. It's so much more. And the people coming up the pipeline, I think what Gen Z wants is to make a difference. And I think when they think of the perception of what accounting is, spreadsheets and crunching numbers, they're not really seeing the whole picture. And the move from compliance to advisory really gave us a chance to capitalize on how it's a whole business picture and how you're helping small businesses and medium-sized businesses grow and succeed. And you're really changing people's lives. And now with the addition of ESG, you're not just changing people's lives. You're able to change, you know, on a larger scale, what the world's going to look like going forward. But then one more point, kind of, I think Sam mentioned this, was I've heard partners say, I've seen the enemy and the enemy is us, and really setting that example. So it needs to start when you have those first years in the office. Are they seeing their partners chained to their desk? What kind of flexibility? What does the leadership look like? Because those people are talking to the people that they went to university with and that they, you know, it trickles down. And so if they're not coming in excited about the future and seeing their firm led by exciting leaders, they're not going to be excited about it and they're not going to share that message.
Yeah. And my answer would be, if I may chip in with something, is that accounting types, and I'm not an accountant either. I'm a former high school math teacher. I'm a part qualified accountant. I thought I would go into it as a career, but it never worked out for me. I wasn't smart enough. But we get so close to what we do, we don't see it as remarkable. It's called proximity bias. It does have a term. And so all of the great things accountants do, they just see us quite mundane and ordinary. Well, that's what we do. We do it for a living. And we change lives. Yeah, big deal. And they don't play that up enough. So that would be that we tell those stories a little bit more. We did a series where I asked 110 influencers the same 5 questions. It's now out as an Accounting Answers podcast. That's what it's called. So it's out there in the podcast world. Jeff, you were one of those that contributed. Question 4 on that was, what could the tech software vendors be doing better to serve accountants? So we're going to ask that question again here, because we know they are very much in the mix. The tech, the talent are right at the top of priorities for accounting firms. I'm hearing stories of tech software providers sticking AI on the list of benefits or promises that their tech delivers. We know that that's perhaps a bit of artistic license. But Jeff, where would you start with that? What role do the tech people have in this?
The tech companies are incentivized to optimize the short term, right? They have quotas to meet. They want to sell you pre-bought accounting licenses that you then distribute to your members or to your franchises or to your offices. They have to meet short-term numbers, and I understand that. But boy, I would love to see the tech companies play the long game here And one of the things that is a pain point for the small business world, small firm world that I live in, is that nothing is really connected. So we are out here trying to grab a piece here that's an accounting software and grab a piece over here that's tax software. No, let's negotiate with a payroll vendor and let's figure out our proposal software. And now we have to go through a grueling process of make them talk to one another and operate together. And guess what? Somebody who's running a $800,000 firm, husband and wife, they don't have the time to do that. And it's incredibly difficult. There are major tax software providers, the major tax software providers, that do not open up their platform for API integration. So that means that cloud-based software can't talk to tax. And that is a massive headache. And I'm talking about on the scale of tens and tens and tens of thousands of firms struggling with this on a daily basis. And so buying the technology and integrating it is a major headache. Play the long game, get these things working together, and give us a vision for how to just show up to work and do the work without having to be IT consultants would be a big win.
Sandra, you talk to a lot of tech CXOs in accounting firms with your circles. There are some big players in the tech game, multi-million dollar market caps. They're very powerful players. As Jeff said, they have goals, they have rotas. They don't necessarily talk to each other well. You're hearing it from all sides. What's your take on the tech role here?
I would concur with Jeff that the big ones, the ones that are the big companies that we all know about, we don't even have to say their names, right? That we know they're out there. I think that they're so focused on making sure that today's software is working that they are not putting enough emphasis or enough of their resources into what's going to happen 5 years from now. So I think they have to do that. And I know that's going to be painful for them, but they've got to. I mean, because there's a whole lot of other technologies coming around. Like I said, we vet them every day. And every day we see 5 or 6 new ones that come to us and say, we would like to get in front of your audience, right? Well, we can't put them all there. So we vet the ones that we can. But there are some really substantial, really great companies coming along that I think are going to eat the big guy's lunch if they don't watch it. So I think be watching for what's coming. I also would tell you that the other thing that's getting in the way on the tech side is there's so many firms out there, I don't care if they're tiny or if they're huge, that don't really have a plan for where they're going. So there is no strategic technology plan in place. There's no budget in place. There's nobody that's being the true CIO, person that's really going out there, finding the best solutions, the ones that will integrate and putting them into place and then training everybody. There's just not enough emphasis there. I think everybody thinks it's just going to happen, right? And it's not. You've got to have a leader in that area. So I think that's a really important piece of what this audience needs to hear. And then the last thing, and you brought it up already, which is AI. Look, AI is out there and it is in everything we do already. Now, I think it's going to be more pronounced and we're going to have more of those solutions. And there, you know, a year ago, we said it's a lot of talk, but there's nothing there. I think this year's the year it's there, right? There's going to be some really good AI there. AI is not our problem and it is not our enemy. Training on how to use it and when to use it and where to use it is our enemy. And that is where we need to spend time, is on the training side of how to use the technology you have, put your tech stack in place, and then use AI to help drive it, because then you have a foundation for the business that's going to be really great.
Yeah.
But you've got to put some time and energy there. So that's what I would add to the comments.
Maureen, it must be so difficult for the member firms you have to make sense of the technology space, because accounting firms have hundreds and thousands of apps and platforms and software tools that they have to use to serve their clients. And I don't know many accountants and firms that are good strategic buyers of technology. There's many big decisions and a lot of money at stake. What's your view on the whole software play?
Yeah, I think you hit on a lot of the points right there. Having the strategy, I think things have been so long picked up piecemeal just to solve an existing problem that's happening right now, that they're not looking at the whole picture and the integration and how things are going to talk to each other. And then it ends up not working. So people end up walking away in many cases more frustrated with the tech than they were with the problem they were trying to solve with the tech. So I do think that, you know, I'm not necessarily sure that this, it doesn't necessarily fall into the responsibility of the tech providers, but much to your point that you have to be strategic about what you're buying. And I think when the craze came about and people were just filling a need, that was okay. It worked, but now it's not. And, you know, there were these big companies without a lot of competition. You know, it was like, we have this. It's not great. Nobody loves it, but it's all we have. And now the competition is coming into the market, but people shouldn't get too excited until they are able to look at the long run and the big picture.
It's going to be interesting to see what plays out. Some of these big players can afford to advertise at the Super Bowl. I mean, what hope have the smaller players got in competing against that? But hey ho, it is what it is. Sam, how do you view the whole tech software space for accountants?
So I think it goes back, as everyone has said, it's about your strategy. I mean, I think it's probably your second biggest line item after people is going to be what you spend on tech and how you view that tech. Is it just something that helps you meet a deadline, get a job done, solve a current problem? Is it something that's about fundamentally changing the way that you work into the future? And I think I like to think about tech as part of an innovation strategy rather than as a tech strategy. So how are you innovating? How is the profession changing? And then what tools do you need to support that new world, that new environment? So for me, it's a big strategic bet. It's a lot of money. And I know firms are struggling, you know, to fund those sorts of investments that give them that long-term innovation edge.
Yeah, tech, it's hard living with it, but we can't live without it. It's an ongoing play, and accountants are right at the heart of that. Let's pivot slightly and give you all a soapbox, as we call it in the UK, a platform to have a little rant, a little rave. And I'm going to ask you, we'll start with you on this one, Maureen, about any faulty thinking you feel is out there that's holding professions back. Any fake news, any long-standing myths you'd like to bust? Where would you go with that?
Well, I think I kind of already touched on it earlier, just the fact that people are just stuck behind spreadsheets and chained to the desk, which I know they have been, and changing that kind of busy season perception and what this tech means to the changing of the career. I think that's something that really has to be pointed out. People are talking a lot about it, but if you are up and coming in the profession, I'm not sure that you understand what that means, a kind of knocking out some of those mundane tasks and freeing up more time to focus on the larger pictures when you're working with your clients. So that would kind of be the biggest thing that I would speak about. And also, we've talked a lot about the starting salaries. I think there has to be more transparency in the long game of that as well. Work needs to be done at the starting, but people will often leave for the private sector because they'll be able to make more, you know, going there in the short term, but then they're stagnant, and that's where they stay for the rest of their career, you know, within that range. However, people aren't willing to share within their firms the jump from what you're making as a senior to a manager to a senior manager. Like, they have no idea how that model works. And I know there's a lot of compensation systems, and that's fine. I'm not saying you have to tell how much Jay down the hallway makes, but knowing the range and knowing that, you know, you're 8 months away from a promotion that would make you X, and those kind of things, I think transparency has to change as well.
Yeah, certainly compensation models is very much tied to the partner model, because they've got a vested interest in a big equity pot and a retirement pot and everything else. Sandra, what do you want to have a little rant about today?
All right. Well, the first thing I would say that I would rant about is I keep hearing leaders and firms saying, oh, this will pass. Don't worry about it. This too shall pass is not going to happen. Change is happening. Change is here. We need to get ahead of the game. We have got to quit saying we're going to someday, and we got to start doing now. So I think that change leadership is, you have to have a senior leader in place that's going to really drive change leadership in your firm. And if you do not have the right managing partner today, get them. It is time to let go of some of the past and get some new blood in there. So that's the first thing I would say. Second one is, I hear people say all the time, there's not really any good talent out there. We're not graduating enough. We don't have enough people. Listen, they're there. And they're judging you on if they want to work for you or not. When they come and talk to you about going to work for you, they're going to ask you good questions on, what are you going to do to train me? To Maureen's point, how much am I going to get paid and how fast can I grow? How soon can I get in front of the people? What's your culture like? What are your values? They're going to ask you hard questions. And if you're not able to answer them, they'll go down the street and they're out of there. So you got to sell yourself. And the last thing I would say is what we were just talking about a minute ago is technology. If you think technology is going to save the day and you're going to be able to have this amazing piece of technology that's going to make all of your worries and woes go away, you're crazy. It isn't about one technology. It's about a lot of things that make your firm great. And it's not just technology. And I hear that a lot. Oh, we're going to have this one piece of software that's going to save our lives, right? No, it's not. But you've got to do it yourself. So get down to it and do the hard work. That's what I would say.
Well, in a moment, I'm going to give you all two wishes. I'm going to give you a magic wand. And you can wish for that if you want, Sandra, that would happen. But hold that thought for a moment. Sam, what about you? What faulty thinking do you feel is holding us back?
So I think we need to get over the idea that you can't have a work-life balance if you work for an accounting firm.
Are you telling me I don't need to do 90 hours a week?
I think there are firms where you're probably doing, I don't know, 120 hours a week. But I think it's perfectly possible to have a great career and not work more than a 40-hour a week. Occasionally, there might be overtime, but I'm really interested in some of our firms. One, for example, that their biggest selling point is they don't work overtime. So they actually monitor their staff hours and computer time. So it's not a question of everybody says they don't work overtime, but they actually do. They actually monitor the overtime and use of the computer. And if people are on too much, they want to know why. They want to intervene. They want to make sure, is there a problem they don't know about? Why are they working too much? And so it's built into the culture. So I think it's absolutely possible if you're committed to it.
Jeff, Going Concern's been calling out fake news and good stories forever. What's your take on a myth that needs busting or some faulty thinking?
One myth that is holding firm leaders back is this. If I don't work in the same office as my staff, they must not be productive and I can't trust them. That somehow working remotely is bad. Working remote and remote work is great. It's fantastic. What do I mean by remote? Yes, I do mean allowing staff to work from their homes in your market, but more specifically, I mean hiring outside of your market here in the US, for instance, hiring US-based CPAs anywhere. You find the best player for the position. It's not that they aren't trustworthy. It's that you have to update the systems, how you manage your distributed staff that might be all over the country. Great project management software can measure throughput of work, and you'll know if people are doing the job or not. I hear this all the time, Rob, and it's always an opportunity to help a firm and their leadership move from kind of a scarcity mindset to a mindset of trust. We're going to trust our people first. We're going to measure our activities, but not to play big brother, but to measure how efficient we are at getting tax returns done or delivering audit work or advisory projects. Remote work is a great thing for our profession.
It's crazy, isn't it? The moves that are being made to incentivize people to come back to the office. For instance, if you don't come back to the office, you're obviously not serious about your career, so you will not be considered for promotional opportunities. It's crazy to see how that will play out. But let's leave that for a moment and let's start to right some of these wrongs and bust some of these ways in a way that you can make something happen overnight. So, Sandra, let's kick off with you on this one. Let's let the genie out of the bottle and imagine you can click your fingers and something overnight will happen to change the accounting world for the better. So blue sky thinking, give us a couple of wishes.
My first wish would be that leaders in firms would really understand that there are amazing resources out there. And if they could spend time creating their team, establishing a new vision, and spending significant time in change leadership, they would truly create a legacy that will be there for eons to come, right? So that's one thing. I would put that wish on every single firm out there. The second wish that I would have was that we as a profession would be spending more time creating and launching an inspiring message about what this profession holds for college graduates. Those young people do not understand what we do in this profession, and that's a true problem today. I would create that after you create this amazing legacy firm, then I would create the vision for what that looks like. And I would go, I say to colleges, but I got to tell you, some of the most really great firms out there are going into the high schools now. So they are creating that vision way down in the high school so that they can draw people into college and they can get them excited. And then college professors would carry that message. And then we would have a lot more people flooding into our profession. That's what I would wish. That second one is probably my most passionate one. I would get some people excited about this profession.
We'll see what we can do. Sam, people usually get granted three wishes. I'm giving you two. What are you going for?
So I think I'm going to take our discussion out of maybe emerged markets. And I'm going to think a little bit about emerging markets and the profession in emerging markets. Because we're all blessed with really strong professional bodies in the countries in which we live. But there are a lot of countries out there where they need strong professional bodies. They need access to really good quality training. And they need a lot of development to uplift quality and skills in those countries. So my wish is for aid and development to be invested in the professional accounting organizations in emerging markets, to create strong local accountants who will help reduce corruption and improve reporting and access to capital.
That's a noble wish. Are you going for another one, or are you standing on that one?
That'll probably keep my genie busy for a while.
Okay, thank you for that. Jeff Phillips, a couple of wishes from you.
One is about talent, and it's to increase the trust and flexibility that, as an employer, you give your team. One time I was speaking at a conference, a CPA Alliance conference, and brought in the chief human resources officer at a big Silicon Valley software company. And I let her have the floor because I wanted her to tell the partners in this room, there are about 200 people, their HR policies, things like very extended maternity leave, paternity leave, unlimited time off, like ample vacation, and you have to use them. And there was a lot of pearl clutching as she was talking in the audience because I felt the sense that these august firms could never, you know, be as progressive as a software company. But I closed the session by saying, this is exactly who you're competing against. And where would you rather work? So all we have this noble profession. We just need to change some of the blocking and tackling around how we relate to invest in our talent. And that will increase the brand that we are all talking about by making better workplaces. My other wish is, and this is for all firms, is to raise your prices. I don't care who you are. You're worth it. It drives a better business model. It allows for higher talent and retention, and raise it until you get complaints and have the courage to do that.
If accountants could better articulate the value that they offer and the difference that they make to business owners, then raising prices would be a whole lot easier. But I take your point. It's a whole different conversation, but to get wishes. And Maureen, what would you save up your wishes for in the accounting world? You've got two.
So I would probably go back to the rebrand. You know, this was touched on before, but really changing the face of what the public perception of accounting is to get those people interested. And once you've done that, kind of the change management portion of it would be to being open. We need to diversify the people that are in accounting and looking at what kind of personalities, what kind of backgrounds would make a lot of sense in this new accounting world. It isn't just about the people behind the closed doors staring at the computer all day. It is about relationship management and bringing in business and forward thinking. And so what kind of people, what are people going to school for? What kind of personalities? What are the traits that we are looking for? Just having that model expanded when you're kind of exploring the pipeline. So, you know, eliminating some of the barriers of entry for different majors and such to get into the accounting field.
My one wish would be if we stopped calling it an industry and started calling it a profession properly. I know it sounds really picky, but by calling it an industry and not a profession, we don't align ourselves with the legal profession and the medical profession. And these professionals study so hard to get their qualifications and their credibility. But a lot of people call it an industry, and it sounds all a bit blue collar to me. No disrespect to the blue collar sectors, but accountants, they just seem to be on a higher level in that. And we don't talk about that enough, but that's my little rant. Let's just give you $1 million at the roulette table and ask you to make one prediction that you think is definitely going to happen over the next few years in accounting. So this is a surefire bet. Jeff, you're going to kick us off on this one. So just have a little think about one thing you are so sure that will happen, you'd put your house on it. What have you got?
I think we're going to regret the entry to private equity into the firm market. I think there it's going to change the local flavor of the US CPA market. Much like I'm a sports fan, and much like big money coming into college sports is sort of changing the feeling, the dynamic of that. I'm not so sure this is a win for us. And I'm not so sure it's going to be a major investment here 5 years from now.
Sandra, crystal ball time for you. What is definitely going to happen?
I think PE and M&A are going to continue to flare up. I think that there's going to be two things that are going to happen to firms out there. And for those of you listening, this is going to happen. If you're a firm that's transforming, you're growing, you're thriving, you are changing your business model, you're going to survive and you're going to thrive. For those firms out there that are going, this is all a bunch of bunk and it's not going to happen. You are stuck in the old model. You're either going to go out of business or you're going to be acquired. And either somebody with PE money or who wants to really acquire other firms, you're going to get eaten up. That's your choice. Choose what you want to be.
Maureen, one surefire prediction from you. You're putting it all on black or red at the roulette table. What are you going with?
Well, I have to say, I can't believe we made it through this entire conversation with PE just coming up right now. So I would say there's going to be changes to the partnership model. You know, not only are we trying to get people into the profession, we're trying to get people to advance the partnership. And people are looking at partnership and they're looking at the buy-ins and they're looking at the long hours. And none of that is super appealing. And you're watching firms fail because of a lack of succession. That's where this, you know, in many cases, the PE is driving, is able, the need for PE is coming in because there's no succession plan in place. And they have these huge partner buyouts. And so the younger people are looking at this going like, it's not going to work. So there's going to be some transformation to what the partnership model looks like going forward.
That's pretty safe bet. One of the five questions we asked on our Accounting Answers podcast, those five questions for the accounting world, question two was, will the next generation of accountants be any different from their predecessors? And of the 110 influencers we asked, and like I said, Jeff, you were one of them, the consensus was yes, but what the nuance brought out was how that generation will be different. If there was any consensus, it was that they would be very tech savvy. They will run firms differently, but they won't stand for the partnership model and they won't stand for being chained to a desk and they won't stand for a 40-year career. They want meaningful work. They want it now. They want the best technology. They want interesting work. They want validation. They want good compensation, of course. All of these things came out. So yes, we're going to see a shakeup for sure, and private equity is going to be a big part of that. Sam, what is your big prediction that you're going to leave us with?
Well, mine was going to be PE. So... I think my point was going to be that I think it's going to reshape completely the firm landscape as we know it. The firm names that we see today, some of them will be combined, merged, disappeared within a year's time, driven by PE. And I think a lot of that is going to be driven by the need to invest in tech. And as Maureen said, you know, there's no succession. If we haven't thought about who's going to take over my firm and we haven't delivered, you know, tomorrow's leaders and then thought about the leaders after tomorrow, you know, that's a problem, because I talked to some of my firms who've been around 150 years, 100 years, and those are the ones who've really thought every time about longevity. Everything the partners do is predicated on creating an environment for the partners of the future, not for the partners of today. And so I think if you're not thinking like that, PE is going to enter your equation, and the landscape we see is going to look very different. And it won't just be US-based. It will be across the world.
Yeah.
It'll be every market.
And the people that run accounting firms, this generation, the baby boomers, if you want to call them that, 75% of them are at or close to retirement age. So we have a massive transition, a transference of wealth coming up, and who knows how that's going to play out. You guys more than most. Let's finish with some messages of hope here as I ask for your final comments. And I'm asking the question, why is this a great time to be in accounting? Yes, we've talked about challenges. Yes, we've talked about constraints. Yes, we've talked about the brand of the profession and how tech is playing their role and the talent shortages and everything else. So we've scratched some itches. We've solved some problems. Jeff, I'm going to start with you on this one. Why is this a good time to be an accountant or indeed working in the accounting world?
It really is. And one of the reasons I enjoy is working with the my fellow panelists I have so much respect for and have learned so much for in this conversation, learned so much from. Look, there's a reason why the private equity industry wants to invest in this profession. There are 31 million businesses over here in the United States that need compliance, accounting, advisory, they need payroll and other services. And the trust in the CPA brand is exceptional. So it's an incredible time to be in a position because there is demand, there is respect, there is profit to be made. And all we really have to do is take some of the cues that we've talked about in this conversation, fix core business models that are the threat. That's how we started. And at the firm level, we're going to be great. So I am so bullish on this profession, and I'm bullish on the talent coming into the profession and us solving that problem.
Amen to that. Sam Louis, what message of hope would you leave us? Why is this a good time to be in this game?
So I used to work for CIMA, the Chartered Institute of Management Accountants, and our then CEO always used to like to say, there's never been a better time to be a management accountant. And he was saying that kind of, I don't know, 5-10 years ago. I think I still think he's right. There's never been a better time to be an accountant. And that is because it's a profession that changes. There's always something new. Sometimes you might think, oh, stop, I've just got to grips with this, you know, but you're never bored unless you choose to be. And I think that's why it's a great profession to be in.
Well said. It does change. It perhaps changes a little bit more slowly than we would like it to. We've just got to grips with cloud accounting and then AI comes along and ChatGPT and everything else. But hopefully we're moving on from spreadsheets. Maureen, what would be your parting comments for our audience as a message of hope? Why is this a good game to be in?
Yeah, much to what Sam said, it is a time of change. I think this maybe 10 or 15 years ago, the New York Times said that accounting was a dying profession and that AI or technology was going to be taking people's jobs. But what we're finding is it's not taking your jobs. It's making your job maybe a little bit easier. It's taking away the boring parts. But accountants are doing a great job with keeping up and evolving with what their clients need. And really, you get just to touch on everything. It is really exciting. You come into a firm and almost any interest you may have, you can probably fulfill that interest at your firm. So I just think it's a really well-balanced, exciting, evolving profession.
Sandra, it's fitting that we finish with you over at Brumer Consulting. You've been such an advocate and champion for this profession for many years. So we know that you will be bullish about it, but tell us why accounting is a great profession to be in right now.
I love this question so much, but you know, we have built-in respect in this profession. And right in front of us, there's this amazing growth opportunity that all you have to do is reach out and take it and make it a part of your firm. We also know that flexible work works. And so there's new talent out there that we can recruit and bring into our firms that we've never had before. John Maxwell made the comment, leaders have to lead. And in this position, in where you're at today, all of you listening, leaders have to lead. We're in a world of change. Today, go out and make it happen.
We're all ambassadors for this wonderful world, so we should all be telling the stories and bigging it up. Thank you so much, all of you, for your passion and your candor and your insights today. That's been a wonderful discussion on the future of accounting.
Thank you for listening to the CPA Trendlines podcast, a production of cpatrendlines.com, now available on iTunes. We hope you'll rate and review us wherever you find your podcasts to help other accountants find our show more easily. For more information, you can go to cpatrendlines.com.